Hello friends, welcome back to our channel NEET Biology Expert. I am Dr. Parveen, your biology professor. In this lecture series, we are studying about the class 11 biology, the first unit living world. In this particular lesson, we are going to study about the taxonomical aids, or we call this as tool for study of taxonomy. Let us know what are these tools and why they are used like this. What is taxonomic aids? What is taxonomical aids? Taxonomical aids are techniques and procedures. They are stored information that are helpful for the identification and classification of organisms. See, so far in the taxonomy, we have classified the different organisms, different varieties of plants, animals, everything. And similarly, in systematics, we identified what is the relationship of this organism with its ancestors. Okay, so taxonomy and systematics are two branches of biology. So in order to do this, and also after doing these things, what we are going to achieve, okay, how we are going to achieve this, so that is based on something called taxonomical aids. These taxonomical aids are some techniques and procedures by which all the information so far, whatever we learned about any organism, we are going to store this in some sort of forms. Okay, so this will be useful for the future studies, right? So that is called taxonomical aids. So we are achieving these things by several methods. First is called via herbarium, botanical garden, museum, zoological parks, and keys. These are all some methods of taxonomical aids. So let us learn what are all this. And so what is the use of this taxonomical aids? Taxonomical studies of various species of plants, animals, and several other organisms. Why they are useful? Because we are using them in various fields, such as in the field of agriculture, in forestry, in many industrial fields, in order to know our bioresources. What do you mean by bioresources? Bioresource means biological resources. So for any country, its bioresources are a major important thing. For example, we have so much varieties of plants, we have so much varieties of animal species like this, okay? So that is a pride of a country. So bioresources, how many bioresources we have and what are their diversity? So these things we could learn by means of this taxonomical aids. And these studies would require to correct classification and identification of organisms. So with the help of this taxonomical aids, we exactly classify the organism, and also we do systematic arrangement of these organisms also. Okay. So to make all this classification, intensive laboratory and field studies are needed. So taxonomical aids are also fundamental for many studies in systematics. Okay. For example, in some cases, the specimen is preserved for the future studies. If we identify a new plant or new species, so we preserve it for the future studies. Okay. So for this, biologists, they always use certain standard procedures or protocols or techniques to preserve these information, so that in future we could track this information. Or if we identify any new species, we can compare, we can identify the systematics with already existing species. So for all such things, we need taxonomical aids. Okay. So aids means with the help of some techniques, with some methods, we are doing taxonomical classification. That is called taxonomical aids. So the first one is herbarium. So you might have seen, or you might have done herbarium in your school in the plus one or plus two. Right. So what is a herbarium? It is a small book or a record book like that, wherein you collect some plants nearby your habitat, and you dry it and store in that, and you will write its description like this and submit your teacher, right? So that is an example for a small herbarium. Same, herbarium is a storehouse of collected plant specimens that are dry, pressed and preserved on sheets. So we collect some plant specimen, dry it, press it, and then preserve it on sheets. Look at this picture. This is an example for herbarium sheets. Okay, so in this herbarium sheets, you can see this plant they pasted here. You can can see this one here, this pathway, they write all the information regarding the plant. Like it is the label. The herbarium sheets carry a label about what is the local name of the plant, what is the biological name of the plant, which date you collected the specimen, and which location you collected it, who is the collector, the name of the collector. Like this, many information details you have to mention in this herbarium sheets. Okay, so not only like this, after you make this collection, everything you have to arrange in an order. Okay, so these sheets are arranged according to a universally accepted system of classification. See, you are making some thousand sheets of herbarium, and if you put it as such in a gross manner, it's very difficult for you to refer it in the future. Then you have to arrange it in a format, right? So for that, the herbarium sheets are arranged in a universally accepted manner. So there is a standard protocol how to arrange the herbarium sheets also. Okay, for example, in the libraries, in the library, how they arrange books as per the alphabetical order or as per their semi code number, like this, they have some set of protocol. So similarly, herbarium sheets are also arranged. So they are arranged and they serve as quick referral system in the taxonomical studies. See, this is a herbarium. This picture is a herbarium. Okay. So here you can see different shelves. They have huge set of herbarium sheets. They are arranged and kept in racks. So any scientist or researchers like this, if they want any reference in the future about a particular species of a plant they have newly discovered, or they want it for research purposes, what is their biological name, what is their taxonomy, like this, so they go and take these details from this herbarium. Okay, so this herbarium is a quick referral system. This is a very important taxonomical aid in biology. The next one is botanical garden. You might have visited so many botanical gardens. And what are botanical garden? They are not just garden, they are not just a play park like this place. They are some special garden where we have different collections of plants from different places. Okay, see, herbarium is a collection of small plants in a dried format. But in botanical garden, what is the specialty of these gardens? They are the collection of living plants. That is important. Living plants. Plants are such living condition. We grow them in the botanical garden. They were collected from different regions of the country or from different parts of the world, and they are grown in a common place that is called botanical garden. So plant species in these gardens are grown for identification purposes. Each plant is labeled indicating its botanical or scientific name and its family name. For example, if you see in Tamil Nadu, a famous botanical garden is in Ooty. Ooty Botanical Garden, where you could see a large, huge varieties of flowers and different varieties of trees. Okay, more than 500, 600 varieties of rose flowers we could see in the botanical garden. So those are all sometimes hybrids. So in those botanical gardens, they will have expert biologists, they will have trained people. They do their own stem culture or they do their own tissue culture. Okay, and they maintain the hybrid plants. Okay, so see this picture. This is a botanical garden, and in this garden, these plants are this huge trees where you could see this one. This is the label which shows what is the local name of this tree, what is the biological name of this tree, what is the age of this tree, what is the origin, from which country this tree came. Like this, many details will be placed in the botanical garden. So who usually maintain the botanical gardens? Mostly state government, central government, they maintain, and sometimes private organizations also maintain this botanical garden. So these gardens employ botanists. That's what I told. They employ botanists or scientists who do their own stem culture or tissue culture method, and they grow plants. And they also have gardeners to look after the plants and to take care of the plants. So some few examples of botanical garden are, one of the largest garden in the world is Kew. Kew is the name of the garden which is located in England. This is Kew Garden in England, which is one of the largest botanical garden having thousands of varieties of the plants and trees. Okay. In India, one of the very famous botanical garden is Indian Botanical Garden, which is located in Howrah. This has been renamed now as Acharya Jagadish Chandra Bose Botanical Garden, where we could see very large varieties of very rare species of plants and trees. So one example of this is this banyan tree, which is around 250 years old, and it has almost 2500 prop roots. Okay, in this tree they have prop roots, and this is distributed almost around 14,500 square feet area. So such a huge tree it is, and very ancient tree also. So like this, and another important thing in the botanical garden we could appreciate is Victoria Amazonica. So this is called giant water lily. Look at this. These are all the leaves of this water lily, which is almost 2 to 3 meters in diameter. So one can sit on this, one can jump from one leaf to another leaves like this. Okay, so such a huge water lily this is. All such rare plant varieties we could see in the biological garden. And third taxonomical aid is a museum. You might have seen small museum in your school, in the biology lab, where they keep in small jars with a formalin, with all this frog, tadpole, like this species. What is a museum? Generally, biological museums are set up in the educational institutes such as schools and colleges. This museum will have collections of preserved plants and animal species which are used for study and reference purposes. So look at this picture. This is a simple museum specimen where in this jar they have kept tadpole, small frog, like this varieties of small insects. These are preserved in formalin. Okay, and here you could see they are labeled. So if anybody looks at this, they know what is the species, what is its biological name, common name, all this information we could get from this museum. Okay, so these are all for study purposes and reference purposes. So museums are, specimens are preserved in containers and jars in the preservative solutions, because in order to store this for a long period of time, it has to be protected without any fungal contamination like this. So they are kept in a preservative solution, chemical solutions like this. Even in medical colleges and all, you could see specimens of a human hand, aborted fetus, eye, brain specimen, all these are preserved in this jar like this. They are also museum. Okay, so this is an example for museum. You might have seen like this. This is called insect box. Have you created your own insect box? This insect box is a very interesting thing in zoology, where you could collect the insect, kill it, and you can pin it. So all these insects are in a dried form. It won't lose any of its morphological character. You can appreciate all the characters. You can see all blue colors, how many blue colors, butterfly with the many varieties. So in this insect box, the name of this organism, its biological name, everything will be printed and kept it. So this is called insect box. And similarly, in some museums we can have the skeletons of animals, like a blue whale skeleton, animal skeleton like this. Okay, so larger animals like birds and mammals, they are usually stuffed and preserved in this skeleton museum. So museums often have skeletons of animals also. Okay, so these are the examples for taxonomical aid museum. The fourth taxonomical aid is zoological park. This is also a taxonomical aid, which is not a normal park. This is a place where wild animals are kept in a protected environment under human care. Okay, so not like in forest anybody can go and hunt the animals. These animals are in a protected environment. So any endangered species or many different varieties of animals, like how plants are kept in a protected environment in the botanical garden, similarly animals are kept in a protected environment with good veterinary care, everything, in this zoological park. So why we have zoological park? Because this enable us to learn about their habitat, food nature, and also their behavior. It is almost similar to their natural environment. Okay, so like this rhinoceros, a swan, like this, all these animals and birds are kept in the zoological parks. All the animals in the zoological parks are provided as far as possible the conditions similar to their natural habitat. This is very, very important. Okay, so any animal which we keep in zoological park, they should not be in a very closed cage, because they will be under constant pressure. They will lose its eating habit or reproducing capacity like this. Okay, they will be under stress and they die also. So it has to be in an open environment similar to how they live in the forest. So as much as possible, we have to give a natural habitat. Okay, so look at this picture here. An elephant is there in a zoological park where you could see people visiting this park. And here, look at this area. So this is a very huge open space. Okay, this mimics its natural habitat. Similarly, many lion and tigers, they are also kept in zoological park like this. Children love visiting these parks, commonly called as zoo. So when you go to zoo, you can see many varieties of animals in one place. So that is an important taxonomical aid, which is called zoological parks, right? The fifth taxonomical aid is called key. What do you mean by key? Key is a taxonomical aid used for the identification of plants and animals based on their similarities and dissimilarities. So it is a method of taxonomical identification. For example, if you have two organisms, okay, so you have to compare between the two organisms. What is the similarity? What is their dissimilarity? In order to compare this with your newly identified organism. Okay, so this is called. So these keys are based on contrasting characters, generally in a pair called couplets. We called a contrasting character called couplet. So it represents the choice made between two opposite opinion. Let us explain with one example. For example, if you identify a new type of bird, you want to put this bird under some category, taxonomical category, right? So what you have to do, you have to compare this bird category with the previously identified birds so far. So here we use the key. So one key is the bird's beak. Okay. So here we are taking four birds. Bird W, X, Y, Z. So you want to compare this bird W with this X, Y, Z already existing. This is your newly identified one. Okay. So you have this key. See, look at this first question. The beak is relatively long and slender. Means if the beak of this bird is long and slender, if your answer is yes, then it belongs to the species Cercidia. If your answer is no, the beak is not long and slender, it is stout and heavy, then it is not Cercidia. Then you go to the next key, next category. That is, the bottom surface of the lower beak is flat and straight. Yes. The bottom surface of the lower beak is flat and straight, means this is Geospheisia. No, it is not flat and straight. It is curved. If your answer is this, then you have to go to the next question. So like this, there are a set of questions. Okay, yes or no, it will be the answer. So these questions are called couplets. Okay, so these are the keys. So in order to identify the organism and put them in a taxonomical category or with the systematics, you use this key. Let us explain with another example. For example, you have found one small beetle or something. Okay. So you want to find out whether this is already existing or this is a new one, or where you have to keep this, the small beetle. So this is your first question. Has the mini beast got legs? That organism has legs? Yes. If your answer is yes, then your next question. Your first question, has it got legs? Yes. Your next question is, has it got wings? If your answer is yes, it got wing. Okay. Is it active at night? That is your third question. Yes, it is active at night. Then your organism is moth. Okay. Suppose no, it is not active at night. then your organism is a butterfly. So similarly here, has it got wings? No, it has no wings. Then your next question here is, has it got legs? Is it more than 8 legs? Yes, it is more than 8 legs. Okay, then it is a centipede. So like this, you have here question no. So this question is a couplet. This is having yes or no type of answer. Okay, so this is called key. What do you mean by lead? See here, this question is a lead because it leads you to the next level. This question is a lead because it leads you to next level. So like this, each statement in the key is called a lead. Okay, and separate taxonomical keys are required for separate taxonomical category. Like this, you can question family, genus, species, everyone for the identification purposes. So the keys are analytical in nature. Okay, so this is called keys, which is used as a taxonomical aid. The next one, few other taxonomical aids are there. They are called flora. So what do you mean by flora? Flora is an actual habitat and distribution of plants in a given area. This is important. Okay. So flora gives a complete count and distribution of plants in a given area. So in one area, in one country or in one region, how many varieties of same plant exist? That detail is called flora. Similarly, we have fauna. Fauna means the same complete account and distribution of animal in a given area is called fauna. So for example, look at this picture. These are about 16 varieties of maple tree leaves. So you could appreciate each leaf is different from the others. That means these many varieties of maple trees are existing in a particular area. So these details are kept as a taxonomical aid that we call as flora. The next taxonomical aid is called manual. Manual is like a book where identification of name of species are found in a particular area. So whatever species of the plants are found in a particular area, it will be recorded in the manual. So when you found any new organisms or any species, you can compare this with this manual, whether this is already existing, what is its name, what is its taxonomy, like this details we could retrieve from this manual. Okay, so manual is a taxonomical aid. The next one is called monograph. What is monograph? Monograph means complete detailed information of a plants and animals will be there in the monograph. Okay, so for example, you know, biography. Biography means a complete detail of one person. Similarly, monograph means a complete detail of one organism or a plant. That is called monograph. So they are done based on their anatomy outlook. If it is an animal, anatomy, how many legs, how many wings, like this and all. Okay, anatomy based on the biochemistry and based on palynology. If this is for plants, palynology means plant pollen, study of plant pollen. Okay, that is called palynology. And how many chromosomes, what is its phylogenetic relationship, okay, and what is its name, nomenclature, what are the keys to identify the organisms, like this one complete set of information about any organism is given in a book called monograph. Okay, so these are the things which we use in the taxonomical aids, and they are all classical methods, right? So here, herbarium, botanical garden, taxonomical keys, we can use it for plants to analyze the plants. Museum, zoological parks and taxonomical keys, we can use it to analyze animals. Okay, again, flora, manuals, monographs are there. They are all printed aids, means in the form of books. They are available in the form of books. We can refer these books to identify any organism. So they are called taxonomical aids. So these things are classical thing. Now, after the computers came, after our biotechnology developed, after we have bioinformatics, we have new methods called molecular taxonomical tools. So what is molecular taxonomical tools? Technological advancement has helped to evolve molecular taxonomical tools from the classical tools to the molecular tools. See, in the previously in the herbarium or in the biological park, like this, we can appreciate any organism based just on their external appearance, similarities or dissimilarities, just by looking their external appearance only. not in any molecular level. Okay, here in this molecular taxonomical tool, we are classifying organisms with the help of their genetic DNA level. So what is the significance? It has high accuracy and high authenticity. 100% the classification will be good. So what are the different taxonomical tools we have? We have PCR, molecular techniques like ELISA, like this many serological techniques are there, DNA barcoding, DNA hybridization, DNA fingerprinting, RFLP, restricted fragment length polymorphism. This is a technique, and DNA sequencing. So all these things are called as molecular taxonomical tools. Let us see this. First one is PCR. PCR is called as polymerase chain reaction. So if we have any organism, just a few number of DNAs are available of that organism, we can amplify this DNA into millions and millions of copies. This technique is called PCR or polymerase chain reaction. So how do we do this? We do this by an instrument called thermal cycler. Okay. So in this thermal cycler, we put the DNA polymerase enzyme and all the nucleotides, adenine, thymine, guanine, cytosine, base pairs, and we add this original DNA, whichever we want to amplify, and set up some condition. After some 3 to 4 hours, we could get millions and millions of copies of the amplified DNA. So what happens? When we give initial denaturation temperature, the double stranded DNA gets splits into two. Okay. And the TAC polymerase enzyme comes and add the nucleotide, and a primer will be there. It will be extended. So like this, after some few 3 to 4 cycles, millions and millions of copies of DNA will be amplified. So with this million copies, we can do further research of what is that organism or any other genetic analysis like this. So PCR is a very important technique in the molecular biology, which is a important taxonomical tool, right? The next one is barcoding. So for example, after you amplified an organism and you studied its characters, so what we are doing it, we just enter all the database in the system, in a bioinformatics, okay? So what is barcoding? It is a short genetic marker in an organism DNA which is used for identifying a particular species. So rather keeping the organism thing in a book, in the form of a book, what we are doing, we are just keeping everything in a database in the form of barcode. See, for example, previously when you go for shopping in the stores, every product they used to write by hand what is the price of the soap, price of the shampoo, like this. Now in supermarkets, what they are using, barcoding. Just scan the barcode, it will give all the details, right? So similarly, if you just scan this barcode, it will give all the details of this organism, its taxonomy, its hierarchy, everything. Okay, so this is the application of bioinformatics here. So molecular taxonomical tool, one method is DNA barcoding. The next one is called hybridization technique. So here, what is hybridization technique? It is a molecular biological technique that measures the degree of similarity between the gene sequences. So it is usually used to determine the genetic distance between two organisms. So if you identified any organism, you want to compare its genetic relationship with another organism, we use this DNA hybridization technique. What is this? For example, you see this is your newly discovered organism. Okay, so you want to compare this with this organism. So first, what you will do, you have to separate these two strands. So double stranded DNA get separated into two single strand DNA. And second step is combine the single strands of the DNA. So take one strand of this one and another strand of this one. Combine these two DNA and allow it for renaturation. So after renaturation, you have to examine whether this become a complete double stranded or not. So if the DNA become completely hybridized, then you can say this organism is identical, because those two DNAs are same. Identical means they again, after denaturation, they get renatured. Okay. So if it is partially hybridized, just half area it is hybridized, half doesn't, means 50% they are related. If they are not hybridizing at all means those two organisms are not related to each other. So for example, take a frog DNA and a human DNA. If you do this hybridization, it will not hybridize because frog DNA and human DNA is completely different. So like this, we can find the similarity between the two organisms' DNA. So this method is called DNA hybridization technique. The next molecular taxonomical tool is called fingerprinting. What do you mean by fingerprinting? So after you identified an organism, you will compare this with other organisms' DNA. So that is called fingerprinting. This is used to identify an individual from a sample of DNA by looking at unique patterns in the DNA. See, this is an example for a fingerprinting analysis which we do in a gel electrophoresis. Usually in the forensic science, we use this fingerprinting method. See, for example, if there is a crime in a particular place, okay, any crime has occurred. So we take the blood sample from the victim and we want to identify who is the culprit. So whoever person we suspecting some four person as the culprit means. So take the DNA sample of the fourth person and compare this blood stain from the victim. Okay, so DNA from the victim and these two suspect criminals. So compare this DNA in this electrophoresis. See here this gel has molecular weight. This is matching, means DNA from this place, you could see here. In this gel electrophoresis, the DNA gets separated according to the molecular weight. Okay, so from this victim DNA sample, it's matching with this fourth person. So this is 100% similar. Then we can say he is the culprit. So similarly, we can identify any DNA sample if we have a pool of DNA sample. Okay, so using this DNA fingerprinting method. So these are the some examples for molecular taxonomical tools. We have some automated species identification tools. So what are these? They are called ALIS, automated leaf hopper identification system. So A stand for automated, L for leaf hopper, I for identification. Yes, ALIS. This is a database. This is a website where how much of a species of leaf hopper we have discovered so far, all those informations are stored in this ALIS. So if you now discover a new leaf hopper, we can go and after our DNA sequencing information is available, we can compare whether this is already existing or this is the new species. Okay. So like this, we have a system called DAISY, ABIS, SPIDER, DRAWING. All these are automatic species identification tools. Here SPIDER. SPIDER is for spiders, wasps, bees. All this insects identification system. Okay. So let us revise what we have studied in this lesson. So we studied what is a taxonomical aid, what are the uses of the taxonomical aids. Okay. So what are the different taxonomical aids we learned? Herbarium, botanical garden, museum, keys, zoological parks, flora, manual, and monograph. These are all classical methods. And we have new method called molecular taxonomical aids, that is PCR, molecular techniques, barcoding, hybridization, fingerprinting, RFLP, and DNA sequencing. So these are all new techniques, molecular techniques. So our next lesson will be about nomenclature. So if you like this lecture, give a thumbs up and share this with your friends. And don't forget to subscribe to our channel, Neat Biology Expert. See you in another lecture. Thank you.